Bad news is boring, isn't it? So this is going to be really, 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 really boring. But putting up with the boring has its rewards. Sometimes it's good to be bored and to maintain your attention in that boredom. The subject matter of this video is the economic apocalypse in the second half of 2011. Bad news, very bad news. And the reaction to that is, say, oh, that's boring. I don't want to hear about that. Too boring. Yes, it is. Yes, it is. The sky is falling. The sky is falling. The sky is falling. Who wants to listen to that? But somebody's got to do it. Might as well be you. As long as we accept the fact that it is going to be boring, don't get your expectations up at all, then maybe it's possible to pay attention. It's important to note that what's going to happen is a fait accompli. It's destined to happen, and there's absolutely nothing anybody can do to prevent it from happening. It's not your fault if you can't find a way to prevent it. So as you're listening here, it's not a matter of you trying to figure out what you can do to stop it. That ship has sailed a long time ago. It was always something that's going to take place. And the simple fact is that it is now going to take place, starting in July 2011. The writing is going to be on the wall. It is going to be very legible for anyone with the sophistication and willingness to read the writing. Events, flags, alarm bells, you're going to see it and you're going to say, I can see what's coming. Now, the writing has always been on the wall, but it's never been so easily legible as it will be starting in July 2011. It will be possible for many people to realize their worst fears are going to come about in terms of the financial and economic apocalypse, collapse, flash collapse, free fall collapse. And I think valid expectations are that towards the end of 2011, let's say late October into November, that you are going to see that actually take place, if not sooner. But I would say the latter part of the second half of 2011 is going to, the events are actually going to take place. Now, many people have been indoctrinated into believing that 2012 is the big year. That's off by a year. In some respects it is, but as far as the troubles go, that's going to take place in 2011. 2012 will be your reaction, your stance to those troubles, and determining a destiny path, choosing it and entering into that destiny path. But the troubles are going to happen second half of 2011. And interestingly enough, there's actually two Mayan calendars. One just is a chronological calendar of time, which shows that 2012 is the end of a chronological cycle. But the other calendar is a calendar of events, and that one has events reaching a culmination in end of 2011. So a lot of people are off by an entire year. Okay, but others are waking up realizing, hey, no, it's this year. It's 2011. That's something that many have understood, like it's going to happen sooner than we think. Now, fiat money, which is money that is accepted as money because governments say that it's accepted as money, that's the problem, because it has no real value at all except the government telling you that it has value. But this fiat money is entirely vulnerable to government saying it has no more value. You see, it's not backed by anything except the whim of those who are telling you it has value. So at some point, those who are truly governing this planet are going to decide that fiat money has no more value. And once that decision is made, it's all been set up and rigged very cleverly for a flash crash where the entire world economy will simply collapse in a free fall into a pile of ruins. And that, folks, is how this cycle comes to an end. And from that point on, then there is a choosing of, well, what path do we want to go on now? And there will be, you know, different destiny paths from that point forward. And many of you who are still listening to this have realized that this is coming, and you've seen the signs, you've been alerted to it, what's happening. Red flags have come up. You say, uh-oh, let's, you know, for a long time. Not just recently, but it's been percolating there. And you're wondering, how bad is it going to be? You know, when is it going to be? Those kind of things. So it's not a big surprise. The only surprise is the rapidity of it. That it's going to be a flash, crash, free fall, drop. So quickly, the entire edifice will just collapse like that. And the severity of it is going to be a surprise. It's a total, all-encompassing situation. It will be a situation of tremendous turmoil and confusion and paralysis and destitution and despair. All of those elements will be so strongly in play. And if you are one of those who's a problem solver, it's an extraordinarily difficult time. And I understand this very well. I am a problem solver. I've tried my utmost to come up with a resolution to this situation. Tried to find out, you know, what can really be done to help people during these times. And still, there doesn't seem to be any answer to that question. Soon, everything will be in play. Okay, it really will be. A lot of scenarios that you've heard about in the past, talking about what's going to happen. Is there going to be some type of help or what? You know, those scenarios will be in play during 2012. Now, I'm releasing this information on July 3rd because I feel that it's safe to do so, because there's no more time to panic, really. It's too late. Perhaps the most important element of all of this is to realize it's not a surprise at all. Many have seen this coming, some very clearly. And it's actually all part of the dynamics of existence. It's what happens. Now, I know that many will try to put a positive spin on it, and I've heard all that positive spin. But that begs a further question, and that is, what is existence? What is the purpose of existence, really? And on this question, there's a parting of the ways between those who believe the purpose of existence is a very noble, wonderful purpose, and those who believe that it is not. The purpose of existence is delusional. Some will say the aim of this is to bring about a higher good, and it's all just part of these great cycles that are always trending, spiraling upwards. And others will say that it's actually an attempt for a massive sacrifice to bring enormous misery, and that this misery will then be utilized in an attempt to accomplish the impossible, and an attempt to actually eradicate or destroy reality. There are very differing belief systems about existence, this universe. What's the purpose? Very differing. I'm very much aware of that. My own viewpoint is its existence is negative. It's an attempt to negate reality. It's a hypothetical scenario of plausibility in an attempt for spirit to replace itself with something new of its own making, of its own device. And therefore, its purpose of existence is to provide, is to find a way to negate reality. Okay, so it's negative from the very beginning. It's negating. That's its purpose. So something like the economic collapse is not a surprise. You know, it's business as usual in this universe. I never had any problem of seeing things as they are and what's going to happen and knowing that, because I just say, well, of course, what do you expect? That's what you would expect in this universe. But to those who see the universe as a glorious process of ever greater growth in consciousness, then it's a little more difficult to see these big bumps in the road. They tend to underestimate it and say, well, it's just a bump in the road. Well, I tell you this, it's more than a bump in the road. It is a roadblock. Very different. And I know in trying to warn people about this for so long that the optimists refuse to believe there's any such thing as a true roadblock, that it's only a bump and there's always a way to get around it, and we shouldn't worry about it. It's a piece of cake, you know. But I'm saying, no, it's not a piece of cake. It's really a crucifixion of this planet. And most of those on this planet are here because they want to be part of that crucifixion, because they believe it will have a very profound effect on the attempts to negate reality. But when one knows that reality cannot be negated, then the whole purpose of existence is a sham. You realize that existence is a scam. There's no possibility of it ever accomplishing its goal. And then that makes one capable of seeing it much, much more objectively. One can see it even as a matter of fact, you know, these events that take place. You just say, well, of course, I can see, you can see this is what is going to take place, and it's just a matter of fact situation. That's how existence carries out its business. Its business is to give plausible evidence that reality can be negated. That's its business, and it knows its business. And it carries out its business, no question about it. And it cannot be stopped carrying out its business. Effects carry out the business of ideas. There's no way around that. For instance, if we chose the idea of instability, effects would carry out that idea, the business of that idea, as instability. We would be experiencing instability, and there's no way you could actually experience true stability within the context of those effects. The only thing you could do is choose a new idea. For instance, choose the idea of stability, and then the effects would carry out the business of that idea, and you would experience stability. What I found is that there's the belief that somehow we have the capacity to accomplish the impossible, that somehow we're smart enough should be able to separate cause and effect, ideas and its effects. In other words, have different effects than what the idea calls for. But it's not possible. You've heard the corporate slogan, nothing is impossible. Well, that's the big lie. It's not true. You cannot separate cause and effects. It's impossible. You cannot negate reality. That's impossible. You've heard the slogan, if you can dream it, you can do it. That's not true. You can dream up a plausible hypothetical scenario of plausibility that it can be accomplished, but it's not actual. And in fact, that's exactly what Spirit has done here. Has dreamed up this hypothetical scenario of plausibility that it's possible to negate reality. And within that plausible scenario, you have worlds and planets and people on them, and you have fluctuations and instability, and you have collapses of epochs and eras and civilizations. You have constructivity and destructivity. That's what happens. And right now we're in the phase of destructivity, very strong. So what these videos, this one here and others I may do, the purpose of them is to normalize it for you and help you realize you can have a perspective on it, which is matter of fact, and say, okay, it is what it is. Okay, the destructive phase of the dualistic dynamic of constructivity and destructivity is now taking place. That's what's happening. And eventually you can get to the point where you can say, ho-hum, boring, very boring. Same old dance. Different dancers, same dance. We keep paying attention to the dancers, and we say, ah, different dancers, different dress, you know, different suit, different ensemble, different outfit, different hair color. And we overlook the fact that it's the same old dance. Over and over and over again. It eventually gets very boring. So I'm saying, please be bored by all this. Please. Be very bored by it. Not by what I'm saying, but by what's actually happening in the world. It seems so exciting, but it's not. It's so boring. And you don't want to be bored to death, do you? We need to find a different dance. A different idea. Choose a different idea. Choose a new idea. Choose an idea that is not trying to negate reality. We could choose the idea of not trying to negate reality. That's an idea. Just like the idea, we chose the idea of trying to negate reality, trying to create a new identity. We can choose the idea of, well, let's try not to create a new identity. And that would be a different dance. Be careful not to try to make this situation interesting of the economic collapse, this dance, this old dance that goes over and over and over. Don't try to make it so interesting. It's not. Don't try to ooh and ah it, you know, and get into all this conspiratorial digging and say, who the players, you know, and what can we do about it? How do we stop them? How do we fight this? And blah, blah. That's the same old dance, too. Don't be like a judge on a dancing contest where you point out, well, I don't like the way that this couple moved, and they need to jazz up the steps a little more, and blah, 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 negative. No. That's still keeping yourself entirely focused on the dance. Choose a new dance altogether. Get up from your judging seat and say, this dance bores me. I'm tired. I'm through with it. I'm going to go somewhere else and watch a better dance. The dance of negation is a very, very boring dance. Ceaseless constructivity followed by destructivity. That's all that it is and ever has been or ever will be. So ultimately, you end up choosing a new idea out of sheer boredom with it all. Without a doubt, the most terrifying feeling is boredom. I went through that once and became so frantic. It is the worst. Nothing worse than that. Existence is incredibly boring. When you feel that, you realize, uh-oh, I've got to find a different idea, a different dance. Got to. And as you look about, you realize that this world is populated with people who are still very interested in this old dance. You know, they're fascinated by it. And they're going to continue watching it. And commenting on it and judging it. But for those who have reached that point of boredom, it's essential that you begin being inspired to choose a new dance. Don't get entangled in trying to judge what's taking place. Just wave it off. You know, like, boring. Next. There are some teachers, you know, around in this world that just wave it off like that, like, so what, you know. It's always been instability, always will be. Don't give it any heed whatsoever. That's the right thing, that's the ticket. My sense is that for many, though, that's a little too absolute, in that many want to at least be told, you know, yes, this is happening, and give a little bit of background to it, which is what I'm doing. I'm filling in that gap. But ultimately, you're going to that high indifference. And beyond the high indifference is actually choosing a new idea. That's even better. It's one thing to be completely indifferent to the dance, or largely indifferent. And it's another thing to choose a new dance, choose to watch a new dance. That's the real goal. as long as you hold on to the idea of trying to negate reality, you're going to have some fascination with this dance of construction and destruction. And it's impossible to have no interest in it whatsoever. So it's really not a very good goal to set to try and attain, you know, perfect indifference. You're never going to attain it. Those who come into this world with that perfect indifference actually are have a different idea, the idea of not trying to create a new identity. So don't struggle with that at all, you know, but follow your boredom. Okay, I know some teachers say follow your joy. I say follow your boredom. That's more important. Is the world boring at its very root? Yes, very boring. Pay attention to that. Don't try to turn it into something joyful, because it's not. It's unstable. It is construction and destruction, ceaseless hypothetical scenario trying to generate plausible evidence of plausibility that reality can be negated, and thus give space, give possibility to creating a new reality, you know. So that's what it really is, and there's no joy in that. There's no real joy whatsoever. It's not stable. Whatever you find, it's not stable. And ultimately, that instability is very, very boring. So pay attention to your boredom. Those who really feel the boredom have the capacity to pay attention to those who are pointing towards freedom from that boredom. It's very sobering. Get serious. When I experienced that boredom, I got very serious. I realized I want to get free of this boredom. I'll do anything. I will pay attention for a long time if necessary. You can see in the world so many efforts to keep making all this interesting, right, and attractive. Massive, massive efforts to keep the entertainment value of this very boring story going. So many bells and whistles and special effects, all in attempt to do this. Don't trust it. Trust your boredom. That boredom is informing you properly. It's telling you this is how it really feels. All the rest is just glitter and tinsel. There's such an attempt to whip up excitement about it all. And those who are bored are called old-fashioned, you know. How come you can't get with it, man? It's so new and innovative and exciting, you know, that we have all these gadgets and we're able to do all this stuff, and the world is so full of interesting things to do and entertainment. Wow! Don't fall for that. The wise don't fall for that, because they trust their boredom. And don't try to go slumming, you know, into that excitement. The best place to be is in a fabulous place, beautiful place, with money and the high life. Why? Because then there's no excuse. Because if you're in one of the best places in the world and you're still incredibly bored, then you realize there is no excuse. You'll trust your boredom more that way. But if you keep throwing yourself down on the bottom and slumming, and then you have an excuse, you say, well, if I was just rich and wealthy and lived in a beautiful place, then everything would be great, right? So you spend more and more time trying to get there. But if you're already there, and then you still feel the boredom and the unhappiness and the misery, then you say, whoa, something's really wrong here. I better wake up and pay attention to what's going on, because I know that there's really nowhere substantially better than where I'm at. I'm in a great situation, and still everything is terrible. You see, that's so important. I was blessed with that. I was lived my whole life in one of the most desirable places in the world, and still had all the problems, complete pure boredom, horrible. You see, and then I realized, wow, you know, there's really hardly any place better. And I even went to places that I thought might be better, but no, I'm still in a fantastic place and situation, and yet it's all terrible still. No excuses, you see, no excuses. So don't play the game of plausibility, and don't go slumming and think, hey, if I go primitive, then what happens is you have a great excuse then. If you go tribal, go primitive, you'll say, ah, I just need to build up a new civilization and get all those things, and once I have it, then that'll cure the boredom. No, it won't. Stay in a good place so you don't have any excuses. Stay in a place where the weather's great, the food is great, the landscape is beautiful, everything is just great, and then feel your boredom, and that'll really sober you up. And stay healthy, by all means, stay very healthy, because then you won't have an excuse for that either, right? Because if you're sick, you'll say, ah, if only I was well, if I felt better, then everything would be okay. Or if you're sick, you might be taking pharmaceuticals, and you think, well, if I just weren't taking these pharmaceuticals, I'd feel okay. It's just the side effects that's the problem. That's the real problem. You see how that's such an incredible trap? Stay 100% healthy so you don't need to take any pharmaceuticals whatsoever. And then you know, you realize, I feel terrible because this horrible boredom, it's existence itself. That's the problem. We often are told the myth that it's the poor people who get saved. It's the opposite. It's the people who have had everything that get saved because they realize everything doesn't save them. All the finery, the fine food and clothes and position. For example, St. Francis had it all, didn't he? Super rich. He realized, my gosh, I'm absolutely miserable. Okay. He didn't start out being poor like that. He just realized that he better get serious and sober up. It's like that. It's the people who have had everything, the finest homes, and the privilege and prestige and all of that, they realize that they're still incredibly bored. And they say, uh-oh, you know, this is bad news. Now some of them try to go slumming, try to take drugs, try to do anything to escape that boredom. It's a big mistake. Okay, so let's get to the nitty-gritty here. You've been waiting this long for it, and I'll tell you this. The real reason for this economic financial collapse is that the world was getting too prosperous. There were too many people having too nice of a lifestyle that they were beginning to realize that the problem is existence itself. Okay, it's not the lack of things, the lack of comforts. In the hypothetical scenario of a plausibility, which is what this existence is, realizes that this has got to be stopped. Otherwise, people are going to wake up. They're going to choose a new idea. In order to keep this plausibility of being able to negate reality, making it seem plausible. I don't think I said that right, but you know what I mean. It's necessary to knock down the standard of living severely, okay? And turn the world into very much an enslaved type of situation, a place of misery. So people will think that, ah, the only reason why I feel so terrible is because I'm enslaved. That's what's really happening. That's the inside scoop of what's truly happening. Let me repeat this. In order to maintain the plausibility that there's a way to negate reality, it's important that people do not feel the boredom and realize that its existence itself, this idea itself, is generating this boredom because it's so futile. Impossibility is completely futile. And people experience that, and they look at their life and say, my gosh, I'm living in a country club, I go to resorts, I got all this great food, got everything I want, and yet I still feel all of this misery, and underneath that is this incredible boredom. Then they say, holy cow, I better go listen to some spiritual teacher and find out what's really going on. And then the awakening begins to take place that way. So you have this great middle class that's grew in capacity to experience this. And that undermines the entire situation of existence, entire purpose of existence. So existence is going to collapse all of that and return this planet to a place of great misery. And then those who want to continue to, with this scenario, hypothetical scenario of plausibility, that reality can be negated, they'll have an excuse. They'll say, you know, no, this, it's all good. It's a great. It's just that I'm, you know, really destitute right now. But if I work hard enough and eventually, you know, I'll get better things and I'll gradually get happier and happier and happier. See, the storyline continues that way. So, the attempt to collapse the economic and financial structure of this planet is an attempt to bring misery to this planet. That's the purpose, and it will do that. So that there's an excuse. Okay? Otherwise, if we continued on in this very high middle class living that many people are reached, they will begin to wake up in mass and realize, holy cow, you know, there's something, it's not these material things that's the problem at all. Problem is much deeper. Problem is the idea itself. The idea of trying to negate reality, that's the problem. And I need to choose a new idea. That's the solution. And we were moving towards that here on this planet. Unfortunately, consciousness, the consciousness, the business of this idea, the dynamics of this idea of trying to negate reality stepped in and says, we can't have this, we can't have this. And so it's pulling the rug out from under it. That's what's literally, that is what's taking place. Unfortunate too. But we had our chance. I took the chance. I understood it and made the most of it. And I hope there's many of you who have done that as well. And I'm just maybe a little bit clearer than some, less than others, for sure. But clear enough to speak about this and let the cat out of the bag, as it were. Telling you what the collapse is really about, what the true dynamic is really about. And if you've had the patience to listen to this all the way up to this point, I know you're vastly more informed now. You've got a different sense, a different perspective of what's really taking place. So congratulations on that. That's the purpose of making this video.